before they were drained in the 17th century, the wetlands of North Lincolnshire formed a vast area of fen, bog and marshes. Life was hard for the scattered population who inhabited this inhospitable wilderness. There were paths through the morass, but to stray from them meant almost certain death in the dank, unforgiving waters of the marshes. Even by day, they were places to be avoided. By night, they were the haunt of the marsh demons, and only a fool would venture forth. Many of the tales in the fens of the terrifying jack-o'-lanterns that haunted the marshes and reed-fringed pools, telling of how they flickered and danced above the swamps, almost weaving a spell over whoever saw them. They seemed to take a mischievous delight in inviting lonely travellers, crossing the marshes by night to leave the safety of the narrow pathways and follow where they led. The yellow flame-like appearance of the lights were described as looking rather like a candle in an old-fashioned horn lantern. From a distance, they could resemble a light in a cottage window, so an unwary traveller, perhaps a stranger in the district, might well head that way, only to find himself further lost and in danger from the treacherous bogland. The Tiddy Mun, the little man, without a name, was another fen spirit who controlled waters, mist and pestilence. Although he shared his domain with the dark spirits, Tiddy Mun himself was not thought of as evil. In fact, a certain affection was felt for him, but he could be dangerous if angered. He dwelt deep down in the green water holes and came out at evening when the mist rose, like a wizened old grandfather with long white hair and a long white beard all matted and tangled, and a long grey gown, so they could hardly see him in the dusk. But they could hear him, whistling like the wind and laughing like a peewit. He was not wicked, like the rest of the fen spirits. Indeed, in the wet season, when the water rose and threatened to flood the marsh folk, whole families would go out together, shivering in the darkness, and call on the Tiddy Mun to help them. They would call until they heard a cry like a peewit across the marsh, and sure enough, the following day, the water would have retreated. All this changed in the 17th century, when Dutch engineers were brought in to drain the fens and turn them into agricultural land. The marsh folk were resentful, seeing their way of life was about to be destroyed, and warned the foreigners that they risked incurring the wrath of the marsh spirits, including the Tiddy Mun. The engineers took no notice, and the dikes and the drains began to spread, and the waters began to recede. Then one day, one of the Dutchmen disappeared. He was followed by another, and then another. Every time a workman drowned in the pits, the locals said it was the work of the Tiddy Mun, angry that his habitat was being destroyed. In fact, it was the locals who were murdering the intruders. But no one likes to be accused of something he hasn't done. By trying to use the Tiddy Mun to cover their own dark deeds, the marshmen only incurred his wrath. A malaise fell upon the Lincolnshire fenlands. Milk curdled, crops failed, cattle sickened, and children fell ill. Soon the little ones were dying. The desperate villagers believed they were being punished for the draining of the marshes and decided to appeal directly to the Tiddy Mun to tell him it was not their fault. Gathering their collective courage, they ventured to the edge of the receding swamp on the night of the new moon. They had agreed amongst themselves that the spirit could only be appeased if the waters returned. Each person had taken along a pail of fresh water, which was poured into the ditch built to drain the bog, while the Tiddy Mun was beseeched to raise his terrible curse. As the water splashed into the dike, a terrible moaning filled what was left of the old marshland. One woman said it was her dead baby calling to her, Others felt tiny hands caressing them and cold lips kissing their faces. Many later spoke of soft fluttering wings all around them. Then, from out of the darkness came a long screech of a peewit. The lonely cry seemed to reflect a sadness even greater than their own, and the bereaved mothers wept. But the men felt at peace, for they knew they had been heard, they knew the curse had been lifted. In the days that followed, the sick children recovered, the cattle grew fat, and the crops came in. And after that, every new moon the marsh people would go to the edge of the dike and pour in their jugs of water in grateful tribute. All had to go, unless they were on their sickbed. Those who missed the ceremony would be cursed worse than before, and all manner of ill luck would befall them. As the last drops of water fell into the dike, Tiddy Mun would reply the cry of the peewit, echoing across the flatlands. But the flatlands were also becoming the drylands. The march of progress could not be stopped. The draining of the marshland continued. The Tiddy Mun's kingdom was shrinking like a rock pool, left behind by an outgoing tide. And one night of the new moon, when the marsh people gathered to pay their tribute, there was no reply to their calls to the Tiddy Mun without a name. They listened for the reassuring cry of the peewit, but there was only silence.